part of that. Hey, listen, over the last several weeks, we've been talking about the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God, and it's been so incredible, and so many things that we've learned about the difference between the kingdom of the world and the kingdom of God, and that there are boundaries for the kingdom of God. And then we know that when we step out of those boundaries, right, then we are out of the good graces of God, and we don't get to experience the things that Ms. Nancy just talked about. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, right? We begin to realize that if we want God's provisions, then we need to stay within the boundaries that he has placed for us. We begin to learn. Jesus himself said what? He said, the kingdom of God is like this little child who comes to me humbly, who's willing to be disciplined, who is so hungry and eager to learn. The kingdom of God is filled with people who see their heavenly father as just that, a heavenly father. And we're children in his sight. And we also learn that it's like a net that's being dragged through the sea. And they bring that net to the beach. And what do? They separate the good from the bad. We begin to realize that there is separation in the kingdom of God. You cannot hold both a passport into the kingdom of God and still hold on to your passport of the world. You have to let that passport go and enter into the gates, because he's calling us into that kingdom. And in that kingdom, there is everything that you could ever ask or desire. Now, does that mean that once we're in his kingdom, we won't face hardship? Of course not. Does that mean we're not going to face pain? Of course not. But we have to remember that this kingdom isn't something physical, it's spiritual. And I'm going to tell you right now, I am not just a citizen of the United States of America. More importantly, I am a citizen in the kingdom of heaven. And I will serve that king and that king alone. He is my king. And so the question now becomes, what do we do once we're in the kingdom? What are we supposed to do? You're here today because you are part of the kingdom of God. So what are we supposed to do? You know what, man? We serve. There's no other way to put it. I want to show you what Jesus says. Remember about how he said at some point the kingdom of God is like a man that went and planted his field. In the middle of the night, an enemy came and planted tares within that field. As both the wheat grew and as the weeds grew, his workers came and said, "Sir, did you not put good seed into that soil?" He said, "No, listen, somebody came and scattered that seed." And so they asked the question, "Well, do you want us to go and do it?" He said, "No, I want you to wait. Because in the end, what's going to happen is you're going to collect them all. We'll separate the wheat from the tare, the good from the bad at that moment, and the bad will be thrown into the fire." And that represents the world and where we live and the wicked and the good. And we know that. And it's okay. It's okay to understand that there are consequences and that there are benefits. When we live in the kingdom of God, we are assured our eternal salvation. We are assured what I've been speaking about on Wednesdays, immortality. We will live forever starting now. Pastor, we know we're all going to die. Don't try to think. No, we are. But we die physically, but we will live forever spiritually. And so here's what it says in Matthew. I want to read this because there's another story that defines what the weeds are. It's a parable of the sower and the seed. It's found in Matthew chapter 25. It says when the son of... Oh, wait, no, don't go to that one first. Go to the other one first. Did I give you the wrong one? Go to Luke. I'm sorry. Luke chapter 8, Matthew. I'm messing my nephew up. You can call Granny. She's watching right now. My mom is watching. Y'all pray for my mom. And she's going to get on me for fussing at her precious little grandson. Luke 8. It says, and when the great multitude had gathered, they had come to him from every city. And he spoke by a parable. And this is what he said. He said, a sower went out to sow a seed. And as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trampled down, and the birds of the air devoured it. Some fell on the rock, and as it sprang up, it withered away. Because why? Because it lacked moisture. You've seen that happen. Especially about 3 weeks ago in 104-degree weather, we see what happens with plants that don't grow deep and their roots don't grow deep. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. Thorns, weeds. But others fell on good soil, on good ground, and it sprang up and it yielded a crop 100-fold. You see, good crop yields more crop. Keep that in mind. 100-fold. And when he had said these things, he cried, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Then he goes on in Luke chapter 8, I think it's in verse 11, where he begins to explain this. He says, now the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. And those by the wayside are the ones who hear. Then the devil comes in and takes away the word from their hearts, unless they should believe and be saved. But the ones on the rock are those who, when they hear, they receive the word with joy. And these have no root, who believe for a while. In time of temptation, they fall away. Now the ones that are among the thorns are those who, when they have heard, they go out and they are choked with cares, riches, and pleasures of life, and bring no fruit to maturity. He talks about the tares being what? The benefits of keeping your passport to the world. Of not surrendering your passport. Of turning your back on the worldly kingdom and diving into God's kingdom. He said, but the ones that fell on good ground are those who, having heard the word with a noble and good heart, keep it and, say this with me, bear fruit with patience. Oh, y'all didn't say that loud enough. What do? We bear fruit. We, as subjects in the kingdom of God, we bear fruit. How do we bear fruit? We bear fruit by serving the King. You see, we serve a King who is loving, who is caring, who cared enough for us to take us out of the world to bring him into his kingdom. But now what? Do we just go to church? Do we just worship? Do we just hear a good message? Do we give in the tithes? Or are we bent on serving the King? This King who gave his Son, his only begotten Son, to die for your sins and my sins, which allowed us to enter into the kingdom, now turns around and says, here is what I am interested in, and this is what I want you to be interested in. Therefore, serve the King by serving his interests and not ours. What are his interests? What is it that he's interested in? Matthew chapter 25, it says simply this. Now you can go to there, Matthew. Thank you. It says, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, when the Son of Man, when the Savior of the world, when the one who gave his blood, who has those scars, that gave us entry into this incredible kingdom of God, when he comes in all of his glory and the holy angels with him, then he'll sit on the throne of his glory. You see, the King sits in the throne. He sits on the throne. Our King is sitting, and this is what's going to happen. And all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate one from the other as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. And then the King will say to those on his right hand, you can go to the next one, Matthew. The king will say to those on his right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom. The kingdom. Everybody say kingdom. Jesus constantly spoke of the kingdom. Inherit the kingdom that is prepared for you. Today, Monday, I was listening to some great men of God, but I heard something that kind of caught my attention. Because you know what they said? Well, I'm about building the kingdom. I'm about building the kingdom of God. We have to be about building the kingdom of God. And what I want you to know is this. I'm not saying that they're in error, and I'm not saying that they're wrong, but I want you to know that God's kingdom is built and God's kingdom is established. He doesn't need you to build anything. His kingdom is his kingdom, and it's sure, and it's been established. From day one, his kingdom has been established. He doesn't need us to build his kingdom. He just needs us to help fill his kingdom. Right? Because, man, when we say build his kingdom, we just think, man, that's a lot of work. I'm just trying to cut my grass and keep my grass from dying. I'm just trying to feed my chickens, right? That's my kingdom. I got goldfish that want me to feed them every morning, and chickens when I'm dressed for Sunday service looking at me all pathetic and stuff. Amen. We're trying to build the kingdom. We're working because we have to pay for the kingdom. And But the kingdom is built, and it's sure. And he says, I'm calling you to go out into the harvest because the harvest is ripe. And I'm asking you to help us grow the kingdom of God. And so he says this. Why is he allowing them into the kingdom? Because I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you took me in. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. And then, of course, the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you? When did we see you thirsty and give you drink? Or when did we see you a stranger and take you in? Or naked and clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and come to you? And the king, everybody say the king. I'm trying to establish the fact that there is a king and there is a kingdom, and his desire is that we be his subjects and that we serve the king. And he is establishing it right now. If you want to know what you do as a subject in my kingdom, he says, assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me, the king. If you want to know what he is interested in us serving. And in times when we don't want to serve, in times when we don't think that we are able to serve, he says, just serve. Jesus himself said that I did not come to be served. The king said, I didn't come to be served. If the king didn't come to be served, then why on earth do we think that we should be served? The king said, I didn't come to be served, but to serve. And to lay my life down as a ransom for many. He served us in every way possible. He serves us today in every way possible. He's the greatest king. You're going to bow before that king one day, and not just because he's amazing and he's glorified and man, he's God. You're going to do it because you know that you are now dealing to the one who served us by giving his son, by dying on that cross, by rising again. And so therefore, if I'm going to be interested in serving God, serving the king, what do I do? Well, we don't just serve him by reading the word of God. We don't just serve him by coming to church, by worshiping, by coming on Wednesday nights, by being a part of the things that we have. We serve him by taking on his interests, that we are now interested in what interests him. And what interests him is taking care of those who might be less fortunate. Taking care of those who can't take care of themselves or take care of their own families. James 1:27, he says this, true and undefiled religion is taking care, pure and undefiled religion before God. And the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their trouble and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. If I'm in the kingdom, I keep myself unspotted from the world. And oh, by the way, while I'm doing that, I'm meeting orphans and I'm taking care of widows. I'm feeding the hungry. I'm giving those who are thirsty something to drink. I'm clothing those who might be naked. I am interested in what he's interested in. And sometimes we serve and we are asked to do things that we may not see the need or see the value, but we do it anyway because we are serving God. I had the privilege of going with all of the Southeast region, all the ministers in the Southeast, to a special gathering over across the lake, and then come to find out they were having an election to elect a leader over all of Baton Rouge and New Orleans and here on the North Shore and over on the South Shore and in Raceland and Houma, where Jenny and I were ministers in Berwick for a few years. And they were electing this leader, and I told the gentleman that came on Wednesday, Lord God, you know what, I'm going to go in there, and I know that they want my name to run, but I want to pray for a leader. And what do I pray for? I shared it Wednesday. It's such a great scripture where Paul in 1 Corinthians 15:58, he says, therefore, my brethren, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, be immovable, always abounding in what? The work of the Lord. That's who I want as a leader. That's who I want. And so then, of course, the names get put up. They're nominated, and I just gave up being presbyter of the North Lake section because I wanted to focus on Lakeshore. We needed that. And look at where we're doing. We're growing and we've got chairs out. I'm sorry. And if you had a hard time finding a parking spot, we're trying to add parking. But thank you for dealing with it. Somebody yesterday in our volunteer, our children's volunteer group, Pastor G came to me and said, I had a question that I can't answer. And I said, well, what was the question? How many kids are too many kids, and do we ever put a stop on it? I'm like, uh-oh. And the answer to that question is no. By the way, we jam them in with chew horns and feed them as much sugar as possible just to keep them distracted. I'm sorry. That's not true. But then all of a sudden, my name was up and vote after vote. And I was thinking, do I take the vote? Do I take my name down? Do I take my name down? Because I don't necessarily want that. Next thing you know, you get it, right? And so I'm praying and I'm saying, Lord, I'm thankful that the men and women of this region, the Southeast region, have that much confidence in me to vote. But man, I don't necessarily know that I'm ready and I'm not prepared and I don't necessarily know that I'm qualified. I want you to know that when God calls you to serve, none of that matters. You are qualified. God qualifies you through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. You are qualified to serve. And so your desire should be to serve. Your desire should say, Lord God, help me. Yes, we have a lot of places here at Lakeshore to serve. Put up that picture real quick, Matt. Yesterday we had a volunteer, and this is not everybody, but we had a volunteer meeting for all of those that are helping out and serving in our, but man, they are doing what God has called them to do in our children's ministry. Amen. It's so amazing what God is doing. And there's so many people that weren't in that picture that are a part of that. Man, ushers. Hey, if you're an usher today, can you just wave at me? Right? I know I've got the three of you guys. Give these guys a hand. Because you know what? Like never before in the history of Lakeshore Church, our ushers are actually having to ush. Congratulations, guys. Help people find their seats and stuff, right? Hey, how about the beautiful people that meet you as you come in? They serve. They're serving because they get here earlier than you to get prepared and to meet you at the door, to shake your hand. Somebody comes and they make coffee, right? We're serving one another, but then there's opportunities for us to serve outside of the four walls of this church, because the moment that all we do is focus on what's happening within the four walls of this church is the moment that this church ceases to exist in doing what God has called it to do. So yes, I love that we have such a great group of servers with kids and with ushers and greeters and students and worship. Man, these guys are here. They're here at 7:30, some of them earlier, preparing to help you get to that place of worship. That's what we do. But then we've got to look outside of the four walls of this church. We've got to say, Lord God, what do you want us to do? And that's why we support missions and missionaries. Some of them come here. Some of them stay here. And this is their church home because they are loved here. It's going out. It's helping others. What can we do to not only focus on what's here, but what can we do? Next week is our epic giving day for BGMC. You'll see that in the foyer. We have somebody, Miss Sissy, I think you're selling wreaths. All proceeds go to the epic giving day. I have somebody new couple. You guys know them. He's been our bug man forever. Jacob and his wife, Haley. He kept coming to church to spray for bugs. And he's like, you know what? I need to come and check this place out. And so now the bug man comes to Lakeshore. He sprays for bugs and then he comes. Amen? But he and his wife, Jenny says, thank you, Jesus, because I know who to call. We see anything. But they're not selling things to make a profit. They're selling things to benefit the kingdom of God with BGMC. Today, I have someone very special here. We're gonna have opportunities to give this holiday season. We're gonna be getting groceries for the food bank. Listen, sacrificing so that we can help the community, so that we can feed those who are in need. Yes, we're gonna have an angel tree so that we can meet the needs of kids in the area. But I have a special couple that's here that I want to introduce to you because they are doing the work of what Jesus just talked about. When he said, I was in prison and you visited me. We have a very special couple, Mr. Russell and his wife, Christine Roseberry, from the Interfaith Prison Ministry. And they're going to come and talk to you about what they're doing and a very special opportunity for you and I today to do more than just say, that's great, Russell. That's great, you guys. We love you. We have an opportunity to be the hands and feet to incarcerated women who have children who could very possibly go without during Christmas. We have an opportunity to step in. We may not visit them. We may never meet the individuals that we're supporting. But you know what? We support those who are on the ground doing the work. And so I want you to give a warm welcome to Mr. Russell and Ms. Christine Roseberry today as they come to share with us an opportunity. Come on, y'all can do better than that, man. They've got a huge group of people that are celebrating. Y'all come on up, Ms. Christine. Let me get you a microphone real quick, and I'm going to keep talking until I get this turned on. But we want you to know that as we support you, we appreciate all that you guys do, Brother Russell. We do, man. And this is a huge privilege. Share with us how we can be a part of what you guys are doing and what's coming up. Christine, I'm guessing you're going to get this first.
Yeah, you get me.
There you go. I knew it. That's a good.
Thank you, brother.
How many of you know God's good? Well, that was weak. God is good. Amen. Well, yes, we do prison ministry. We have been doing prison ministry for 43 years. I was out in the foyer area speaking with a woman, and she said, how did y'all just happen to start prison ministry? Very long story. My husband came home one day, brother, and he said, I feel like God has impressed upon me to start going to the prison. And I laughed at him. I said, what are you going to tell them? You stole a piece of bubble gum when you were 5 years old? I said, you don't have a horror story to go minister to the inmates.
I did have a job.
You did have a job, though. But God's not looking for a horror story or someone who has a shaded past to go into the prison. Amen? I laughed. I said, well, God truly picks the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And only, let me tell you this. I told her, she said, well, how'd you get started? I said, God set me up. God will set you up when you're not willing to do what he wants you to do. My husband started going without me. I didn't want any part of it. Two different sides of the track. Mr. Goody Two Shoes.
I had a job.
Mr. Goody Two Shoes married ex-drug dealer, ex-drug addict, in a gang, street fighter, on and on and on.
Had a legal job.
That's true. Whereas I stole everything I owned back in those days. But God set me up. He came home one day and said, baby, you should have seen how I ministered when I went in the prison. And he went 2 years without me. Didn't want any part of it. And he came home and he said, do you know how forward women are? How many of you know women are forward? I said, yeah, and he said, well, I gave an altar call, and this woman came up and said, I'd like you to lay hands on me, but she also proceeded to tell him where she wanted hands to be laid on her. So I looked at him and I said, I feel a calling coming on. And I am telling you, as God is my witness, that's what happened. God set me up because he knew that's the only way he could get me back there. Very long story short, right when I walked in the women's penitentiary, there's a woman standing at the end of the long walkway, and she's yelling my name. And she's like, Christine? And I looked at her, and I said, Linda? And she asked me, she said, what are you doing here? My first ever witnessing opportunity. I said, well, I'm here to tell you about Jesus. And she said, well, you smoking some bad dope. She said, when you come down from your little Jesus high, I will talk to you. And she turned around and walked away. And I stood there thinking, we were in a gang together. She's in there for stabbing a woman. I won't tell you how many times. And I realized the grace of God, that I should be there. I've never looked back. I realized where I belonged, where my calling was, where I needed to get behind my husband. And I did. And I did meet the woman. I won't tell you what I told her, but short of threatening her life. And then I witnessed to her afterwards. But long story made short, we were doing prison ministry, and 28 years ago, we realized that there's a lot more to prison ministry than just the inmates. There's a family left on the outside. There's the mother and the father, and women are getting incarcerated at a rate of over 600% right now than it used to be. And I've got children on the outside. When the state of Louisiana says it's 7 out of 10 kids who have an incarcerated parent will end up in the prison system, my passion is to reach those kids for Jesus. Let them know they've got a better way. And we started Little Lambs, and right now we've got close to 300 kids in our program. We just got 70 new application forms from one prison alone. That could represent up to 200-300 kids that are fixing to come into our program. I could tell you heartbreaking stories, but I could tell you success stories. Let me brag on Jesus. If 7 out of 10, the state of Louisiana says, will end up in the prison system, over the years, we've had 16, 17,000 kids come through our program. And literally, we have only had 11 children arrested out of all those thousands of kids. Thank you, Jesus. And that is less than 1%. I hate using the cliche that Jesus works, but the gospel works, church. Just loving on them and telling them that they're special and that we appreciate them and God's got a purpose for their lives, it makes a difference. My daughter's standing in the back, and raise your hand, Chrissy, that's my oldest daughter. And we have a table set up in the back. We want to reach these kids for Jesus. Look, we've got families in hotels right now that would be on the streets. We've got children. We work with social services, the adoption agencies, the homeless shelter, the street ministry. I want to reach these children for Jesus and make a difference in their life. And if I have to give to them to do that, so be it. It's a year-round program. Right now, we are gearing up for Christmas. So if you visit the table, there's brochures, there's different ways you can get involved. We've got little ornaments out there with the actual faces of the children in our program. And on the back, they have their Christmas wish list. We just finished a big back-to-school bash with the kids. We don't drop everything off at the doorstep. They come to us so that we can hug them and love on them and tell them they're special. But if you would please visit the table, there's ornaments you can pick up. You can actually buy the Christmas gift, bring it over here. We will come and pick up the gifts probably the first part of November, because we're starting to wrap now so that we can make sure that we have all the children accounted for. There's monthly sponsorship. We have a monthly sponsorship packet, where you can get a packet of the child you want to support for $20 a month, and that helps us do what we're doing all year long. There's so many different ways that you can get involved. If you're sitting there and you're saying, I want no part of prison ministry, be careful. Don't ever say never. God can set you up.
Give me the mic, if you don't mind. And the reason why I want the mic right now, Brian, how many of you thank God for your pastor? Not just a bold message, a missions message for the church. And the only missions message that's going to count when you close your eyes in death. We will stand before the King, and he will ask, where were you when I was hungry? Where were you when I was thirsty? Where were you when I was naked? Where were you when I was sick and in prison? I go to the prison, church, not to visit thugs. How many of you thank God that you're not in prison today? Amen. Amen. Some of you maybe have spent time and maybe you're in the service today. Thank God you found the praise house and not the drug house. When I go to the prisons, I'm not looking for the thugs. You know who I'm going to look for? Jesus. Because Jesus said he was there. Church, don't come to see thugs. If you're a born-again believer, come to see Jesus. Because Jesus is hungry. Jesus is thirsty. How many of you have ever been naked or maybe without clothes, maybe without food as a born-again believer? And Jesus is sick and in prison. And the way he's going to separate the sheep from the goats, where were you? I don't know about you, but I had to answer that question in a Bible study that caused me to surrender to wherever Jesus was. And my prayer that day was, Jesus, wherever you are, that's where I want to be. Because how many of you could confess you have been places where Jesus wasn't? If Jesus is hungry, praise God for the church that wants to feed Jesus. And not just somebody who's a homeless man with a sign on his shoulder. Because there are some hungry people today that are Christians. There are some thirsty people that are Jesus today that need fresh water from the Father. And there are some men and women behind prison walls that need a visit from the church. Because they got a bunch of knuckleheads behind the prison system. So my challenge to the church, and look, I thank God for this pastor. For him to preach this message and then invite us up. Brother, you could have kept preaching. And just said, hey, we got missionaries here. But he gave me a springboard. And I got to close because I could preach some more. But I believe it was a convicting message for the church. Church, how many of you want to go be where Jesus is and do what Jesus called us to do? And don't just come to church. Be the church that he's called you to be. We're in the back table. Come see us. You want to support us? Our challenge to the church is we need you to pray, play, and pay.
Come on, give them a stay right here. Let me pray for you guys. Hey, we also have some other missionaries that are with us today. And you know what? I'm Austin, can you come up? Is Catherine with you? No. Where's she? She's the best part of who you are.
That's right.
Is it Ms. Donna Engvall in here right now or Josh Holder? Right? These are current missionaries, men, that we support because they're our hands and feet in places that we can't necessarily be on the campus of SLU, which they're just knocking it out the park right now. Oh, I think 100 people at your last, 100 students came to their life group. And then, of course, man, these guys that have been doing this, they have been involved in this as long as I have been a youth pastor. I've seen them. They have been there, and we want to pray. And so would you consider being the hands and feet for them, to these kids? Would you consider serving the Jesus in your place of business? The one who may not be hungry physically, but maybe they're hungry emotionally or spiritually. Maybe they're thirsty. Maybe it's the people that live next door to you that could use somebody to minister to them, to touch their heart. Be Jesus with skin on to them, because when you do, you're looking in the face of Jesus. Those students, you're serving Jesus. The inmates, your coworkers, your family members, hey, sometimes our spouses, I want to encourage you, serve. Because as subjects to the king, we serve his interest. And we want what he wants, and we do what he wants us to do. Amen? Come on, if you believe that's true, I want you to stand up today. I want you to stand up. And if you don't, we're going to make you stand up or embarrass you for not standing up. But what we're going to do right now, I want you to stretch your hands out to these that are right here, because, man, they are doing it, and we want to help them in every way. Father God, right now, I'm just thankful. I'm thankful for Russell. I'm thankful, Lord God, for Christine and their testimony and the lives that have been changed. And, Lord God, those who have been set free, even though they're behind bars. Lord God, because they went not to see a prisoner, but they went to minister to you. Jesus, bless them and what they put their hands to. And Lord God, may Christine, as she's working, may she meet the need of everyone that calls on her. These 70 new applications, Lord God, help us to be able to help them meet that need in Jesus' name. My man, Austin, Lord God, who's got such an incredible team and is doing great things on that campus. He's not just ministering to students. Lord God, he sees you in those students. Father, may he continue to minister to the students there at Southeastern, to those who know you and are just looking for you, to those, Lord God, that have never met you. Lord God, may they find you because of what they are doing to serve you in Jesus' name. And Lord, to this congregation, may we find opportunities, Lord God, today, to serve you well. And Lord God, when we give, and it's hard to give, may we remember, Lord God, that we are giving as unto you. May we give, Lord God, as Jim always says, Lord, with cheerfulness in our hearts. Because, Lord God, we are your subjects, and we are interested in serving you and doing what you have called us to do. When we minister to the kids, when we are ushering, when we're teaching a Bible study or attending one, when we're inviting our friends, when we're being friendly, Lord God, to someone who is new, we're serving you. We love you, Lord God. We praise you for being a church that is interested in serving the King. Not just interested in their own kingdom, but Lord, we are in your kingdom. And that means that we can't just look in. We have to look out into the harvest that is white and ready. I'm praying that you would send our laborers. And Lord, let us be some of those laborers in Jesus' name. We love you, we praise you, and we give you glory. Come on, everybody, say amen and give him a hand and give these guys a hand today. Thank you, guys. I'm going to release Christine. You guys, y'all go sit at the table. Y'all be ready, because we're going to hopefully get some people to help you out.
Amen, bro.
For the rest of you today, my prayer is that with everything going on, you would seek to serve Jesus Christ in your school, at work, in your neighborhood, at the football game, wherever you are. Amen. Hey, listen, Jenny and I want to say thank you to all of our guests.
Hey, once again, we want to say thanks for joining us. Our prayer is that you felt the presence of God, that you allowed him to speak to you through today's message. But we want you to know that if you need to contact us, you can do that at lakeshorechurch.life. If you gave your life to Jesus Christ today because of today's message, I would love for you to contact us here at Lakeshore. Give us your address. Let us send you some information. I would even love to send you a Bible. Call us, contact us, email us, some kind of a way get in touch with us. If you'd like to give to our ministry, you can also find out how to do that at our website, lakeshorechurch.life. We pray that this is an incredibly blessed week for you, for your family, and we'd love to see you join us again. But until the next time, God bless, and we'll see you then.